Welcome to day two of the Intelligence and National Security Summit. We thought we had a pretty good day yesterday. We're really happy to be able to speak with a lot of you personally in the reception after our sessions yesterday. We heard some very thoughtful comments from the DNI yesterday, a lot about ensuring a smooth transition for the intelligence community as we move to a next administration. And I think we all can reflect a little bit on not only 6 years of the DNI, for which we're grateful to solidify that institution, but also on a remarkable, selfless 54 years of service.
I couldn't agree with that more, Chuck. And one thing I think that we all learned yesterday from both the plenaries and the break and all the breakout sessions was how important and critical your questions and direct engagement with the speakers is to their quality. So I hope you remember all during the day to continue to submit those questions, because they really determine how good the sessions are, at least from your perspective. From the defense intelligence side, you know, as somebody who's been retired for a while, I continue to be very impressed from my perspective over the last 10 years of the level of integration in the defense intelligence enterprise. It is a level of integration I did not see during my tenure. And I think the other very important thing that we learned yesterday that is on the Goldwater-Nichols side, the man, train, and equip approach to intelligence is also something that's going to be pursued, and we'll be seeing the fruits of that, I think, in the coming years. So today on the agenda is, on the plenary side anyway, is to hear from leaders from Congress who are here getting mic'd up in the back room, leaders of Homeland Intelligence, and the national leaders of intelligence. So we have three plenary sessions today. Remember, they all take place in here.
We also have our final track breakout sessions today. We had some great sessions yesterday, some really, really thoughtful discussions on cybersecurity, cyber deterrence, terrorism, technology, and more to come today. Mo?
Yeah, I got to sample a lot of them, and I will say that the terrorism, all of the sessions were amazing, but I was particularly struck by the quality and breadth and depth of the terrorism discussion that we had, led by Charlie Allen. It's among the most thoughtful discussions I've heard in a long time, so that one. I was also particularly impressed with the whole discussion of the workforce. And while we may be all personally frustrated by some slow processes, I'll just leave it at that, a lot of work has been done, and I think there are some very good plans for moving forward. So I learned a lot from that particular session as well.
So before we get started today, though, before we get to the congressional panel, we have one very important thing to do, and that, Steve, is to recognize Steve Ritchie, retiring FCA Vice President for Intelligence, for his 20 years of service to FCA and his partnership to all of us in this room. Speaking for NSA, Steve, we have had no better partner or friend. We'll miss you, we thank you, and we wish you Godspeed in your retirement.
Thank you, Chuck, very much. Wait, we're not done with him yet. No, we're not done with him yet. Steve, you're wondering how Chuck and I went rogue and got this past you, aren't you? You're wondering. Well, we did. One thing I've always said about you, Steve, is your profound humility is among your strongest leadership qualities. And I'm going to guess that right about now you wish that Chuck and I would move on to another subject. But I think you also know that speaking on behalf of the Intelligence Committee, the FCA Intelligence Committee, I just can't do that yet. So Steve, the FCA Intelligence Committee, we are many things, but what we are mostly is a reflection of you, our leader. Your professionalism, your partnership, your gentle humor, and your strong commitment to excellence in public-private partnerships in service of the intelligence profession are the driving force behind all that we do. The committee is stronger because of you, and each of its members, especially this chair emeritus, is better for knowing you. Thank you, Steve, for everything you've done. And thank you especially for just being you. We'll miss you, and we wish you all the best in your next chapter.
Okay, with that, we're ready to get started with day two. Our first session today is on Congress. We can't have a discussion about the intelligence community without talking about the importance of oversight and the importance of a partnership with the Hill in terms of the conduct of our intelligence activities. So to introduce our first panel, I'm pleased to welcome a former senior at NSA, a colleague at the ODNI when we tried to stand up the ODNI and the CIO function at the ODNI, and a good friend, now Vice President of Oracle, Press Winter.
Good morning. My name is Press Winter, and I serve as the Vice President for Strategic Mission Initiatives at Oracle Corporation. Oracle is an American multinational computer technology corporation specializing in database software and technology, cloud-engineered systems, and enterprise software products, both open-source software and our own brands of database management systems. Oracle is very proud to be a premier sponsor of the 2016 Intelligence and National Security Summit. This morning, we continue our examination of the advances, setbacks, and future challenges for U.S. intelligence with a perspective from those in Congress who provide its oversight. As you know, Congress plays a critical role in ensuring the health and proper operation of U.S. intelligence, primarily through its two oversight committees: the House Permanent Select Committee on Intelligence, known as the HPSI, and the Senate Select Committee on Intelligence, the CISI. We are pleased to have both the chairman of the HPSI, Congressman Devin Nunes, and the ranking minority member of the HPSI, Congressman Adam Schiff, with us today for that discussion. They both represent the great state of California and have long and distinguished records of performing rigorous oversight of intelligence in the interest of its effectiveness, accountability, and transparency. Our distinguished panelists are joined this morning by panel moderator Walter Pincus, national security columnist for the Cipher Brief and longtime and widely decorated Washington Post national security journalist. Please join me in welcoming them today. Walter, we're delighted to have you, and please join me in welcoming our panelists and Walter this morning.
Well, thank you all for getting up this early. I used to do a lot. I don't do it that much anymore. But let me get right to the kind of nub of things. What do you see as the state of the intelligence community right now? Sort of what are the big threats? How do you see us meeting them?
Well, thank you. Thank you for having us this morning. It's always a pleasure to be here, especially with my counterpart. And we appreciate you getting up early in the morning to come and listen to us. I think there's no secret what I always call the big issues: China, Russia, radical Islam, including, you know, that also includes not only ISIS, but Al-Qaeda. Then you have the Iran, North Korea threat. And then mixed in that, you have the cyber problems. And all of those actors are involved in cyber plus others. And I don't ever say that one is worse than the other. I think at any given time one can flare up, but I would say for sure that all of those are raising concerns globally. But I think all of you that are here, this is no secret to you.
Walter, thank you for moderating today, and thank you all for having us. I think we've been fortunate to have extraordinary leadership of our intelligence agencies and phenomenal people in the public and private sector that help us meet these challenges. And I think Chairman Nunes is exactly right in laying out some of the preeminent challenges facing the country. Certainly, recently, we have been very focused on the cyber threat because all of these actors that are concerned to us in different ways are using the cyber realm to probe our defenses, sometimes to attack us, sometimes to hack into our systems or even try to put in question the integrity of our electoral process. And this will be, I think, one of the most far-reaching challenges. I mean, we've had these adversaries and rivals for quite some time, but the cyber arena is just exploding as a new threat vector. We see it in ISIS's very sophisticated use of social media, its use of encrypted communications to plot and plan against us and recruit new people. We obviously see it in terms of hacks into some of our institutions, political institutions, even the databases of some of the state secretaries responsible for elections. We see it in North Korea's hack into Sony. We see it in innumerable ways by Russia and China. So while all of these actors are of great concern, we now have to be very much focused on new ways they can attack and new ways that we're going to have to defend ourselves.
Well, talking about cyber, one of the issues coming up is reauthorization of 702. How are you going to handle that?
Well, we've had an ongoing educational process at the committee, I think four or five this year, where we brought in folks from all the agencies to brief members of Congress who are not on the Intelligence Committee on how the system works, actually giving them top secret TSSCI briefings, and so that they can get kind of a feel for old cases, typically is what they are that they're briefed on, but how it's implemented. And we had what I would say wasn't, not a lot of people caught it, but we had a major victory this year on appropriations bill where we were able to turn back any changes to 702, which that's the first time in about, I guess, what, 4 or 5 years that we've been able to do that since the Snowden leaks. So I think we've turned a corner, but education is the key, and Adam and I are going to continue to try to educate all the members of the House as to how important these programs are.
How many members do you think came in?
We've probably had well over 100, I would guess. And you know, and there's, and we've got targeted members. Typically, you know, we've had even on these post-Snowden votes, we've always consistently been around 200 members of the House who have been supportive of making sure that these programs stay intact. But if you look at you know, the 100 members that have been in or so, you know, those are typically members that are not okay, you know, that are not comfortable with the program. So, and I think it shows that we were able to turn the corner this year, because I think we got 240 votes against that amendment.
And it will still, I think, be a challenging debate. If you look at some of the issues that we've grappled with at the intersection of privacy and security, probably ranking them in the order of difficulty, the cyber information sharing bill that we passed to allow immunity for the public sector to share information with each other, with the government of malicious code, that was probably, even though it took us 2 or 3 years to get done, about the easiest lift. We also had the telephone metadata reforms that we did, where we restructured the program so that the telephone companies held onto their own data rather than the government collecting massive amounts of domestic call data. That was probably the next order of difficulty, but we arrived at, I think, a very sensible compromise in the USA Freedom Act to preserve the benefits of the program, but also better protect people's expectation of privacy. I would say 702 is the next order of magnitude more difficult. The program is, I think, far more important and useful than the metadata program was, but there are, I think, some more complex issues that we're going to have to grapple with in connection with that program when it comes up for reauthorization. The most difficult, though, of all of these issues, I think, is the encryption issue. And we are nowhere near any kind of a consensus on how we ought to view that. And I think we're continuing to see that issue percolate, particularly in Europe, where some of the European countries are contemplating legislation to mandate decryption. Chairman Nunes and I asked the National Academy of Sciences last fall to do an analysis for us, an updated analysis 20 years after their last analysis on encryption, so that at least Congress would go into that debate with a set of neutral facts to evaluate what are the trade-offs. But I don't think we're anywhere near a consensus on that. That probably remains the single most difficult issue at the intersection of privacy and security.
But that, do you have your own ideas of how you ought to handle it?
You know, I really haven't reached a judgment on it. I do think that there is a very certain trade-off here, and I know that some in industry in particular view this as a debate between security and security. I really think, frankly, it is a debate between security and privacy. And I suspect that the answer to that is not necessarily the same for the two issues which are often so interwoven that we have to think about it to make sure we keep them separate. And that is the issue of data at rest, data in our phones and devices, is a somewhat different issue than data in motion. Data at rest predominantly is going to affect law enforcement. There are hundreds, if not thousands, of cases already where the phone contains the best evidence for prosecutors and investigators, and the inability to access that phone is going to mean that murders go unsolved, rapes go unpunished, and it's going to have very significant consequences to law enforcement. Data in motion is going to be of more significance to the intelligence community, the fact that we may see ISIS in communication with people and not be able to tell what they're plotting is of grave concern. At the same time, the ability for millions, if not billions, of people around the globe to communicate with each other when they live in authoritarian countries like Russia, like China, Iran, increasingly Turkey, and be able to do so without fear of government listening in is hugely important and consequential. It's also some of the best defense to be able to encrypt data. But there, nonetheless, going to be some very real trade-offs. I'll be looking forward to what the National Academy says about whether we can mitigate some of those risks. My own gut sense is that we can probably find an answer to the issue of data at rest more easily than data in motion, because I think the specter of a third party being able to intercept and decrypt communications in motion is one that is a risk more difficult to mitigate with an encryption solution than data at rest, where you may have a hardwired technical solution where the phone would have to be in possession of the manufacturer to be able to open the contents. That may be something where we can protect against the risks more viably than we can with data in motion.
Are you getting any help on this issue from the government? I mean, from NSA, from the White House? Do they have a position?
I think the administration is probably not monolithic on this issue. I think depending on who you ask, whether they're on the commerce side or they're on the intel side, they may have a very different opinion of the merits of the encryption debate. It's why I think they have taken largely a wait-and-see approach on the issue. We certainly, I think, are very mindful from our conversations with the intelligence community of both the benefits that encryption offers, but also the very real costs and the degree to which communications are going dark, that we don't have visibility into some communications we used to, and the challenges that poses to the IC and law enforcement. So they certainly have shared, I think, those views with us. But I think this is a problem of such significant consequence where the downstream impacts we still only are dimly aware of, that it really is premature for us to try to prescribe a legislative solution, which is why I hope we get some good data from the National Academy.
Mr. Chairman, you're talking about the leadership of the community. What's your view and what's the role of the committee in getting a term, the five-year bill for the DNI and for the CIA director?
Well, I'm not there yet on that proposal. It's been talked about over the years. What we're trying to do is really assess where we are. We just passed the 10-year anniversary for the creation of the DNI. I think we remain concerned that it's a bureaucracy that's growing, continues to grow, and are we duplicating efforts? So I'm just trying to speak kind of think generally where the members of our committee are. I think if you go back and look, there was a need to have a DNI, a need to have a strategic planning type of organization, someone who can deconflict. I'm not sure that it's situated correctly now where you have another layer of bureaucracy built on top of multiple layers of bureaucracy across 16 intelligence agencies. So before we go in and enshrine with a five-year term, I think there needs to be some changes ultimately to the original legislation. Now, how we get from there, the train may have left the station at this point. What's the old saying? There's nothing like perpetual life on Earth in a government program. And that that may be where we are with the DNI, but right now our focus is on is try to keep it focused, try to limit the growth of the bureaucracy.
Because if Jim Clapper's word is stated as true, one of the first things you're going to have to do is approve a new DNI.
Right. Well, that's the way the law is written that way now, and the president decides who the DNI was. And I think that was a debate at the time. Mr. Schiff and I were not on that. We're not on the Intelligence Committee at the time on this, but we were in Congress. But it was part of the debate on, you know, do you create like a 10-year term similar to the FBI? I believe the administration at the time opposed it, and that's. Right or wrong, the law wasn't created that way. I think another problem with the law, just off the top of my head, would be I think NCTC and similar organizations, they do really good work, and they produce good products, but was it really necessary to put them under the DNI, or could they have been left at the existing agencies? And just with more collaboration, I think maybe it would work a little bit better. But like I said, it's going to be tough to make those changes.
I guess the question is that going to be one of your agenda issues when Congress comes in?
Yeah, I mean, it's ongoing. I mean, even this year, we're continuing to look at the role of the DNI. Constantly we have investigations that are ongoing. Does it lead to actual legislation? At this point, I don't know. It could. I'd like to see who the next DNI is and then what role they see for the DNI and what changes would be made with the incoming administration. It's always easier if you work with the executive branch than be in opposition. And I think that's been one of the challenges, I think, is that the Congress is seen and I think wrongly so, as a place the IC tries to avoid versus working together, and I don't think that's been helpful.
I mean, one of the questions from the audience is this old idea, but worth looking at again, about sort of all source analysis, in this case, the merger of CIA and DIA. The military's I always remember when the DIA was put together, it was going to sort of limit the services, and yet the services have their own intelligence agencies that have kept growing themselves. Mm-hmm. Are you going to look at that? Is this, you talk about overlap in DNI. What about the overlap within the analysis?
Well, they do different work. I wouldn't support merging DIA and CIA. However, I do believe that that DIA needs to be completely revamped and looked at, and the relationship with the COCOMs. And we actually are looking at doing a hearing on the role of the DNI with DIA, with DOD. But I think that question gets to a bigger problem, and that is just the behemoth that we have at the Pentagon. It's become big, bureaucratic, and quite frankly, there's just too many people that are working here at the Pentagon, and not enough people out in the field. It's the old, you know, too many chiefs and not enough Indians. And especially when you look at the bureaucracy, the civilian side of the bureaucracy that's built up over time. We're trying to fix some of that in the NDAA. Chairman Thornberry's looking at those. This is going to be one of the issues that we deal with if we get to legislation. But it's trying to reduce the size and scope of the bureaucracy here. And we've been looking at bureaucracies all over the globe, especially as it relates to DIA. I think there's really hard questions that need to be asked about, you know, do we need people sitting in the United Kingdom that are costing us $50,000 to $100,000 more a year? I think those are all good questions. But in terms of the merger of CIA and DIA, I think would be a mistake because, you know, largely they're looking at different topics in areas.
I would just add that, and I guess this is in the context also of the question you asked earlier about DNI, that we've seen in the years since the reform that established the DNI, I think much better cooperation and sharing of intelligence, and we have seen, I think, a significant dismantling of the stovepipes that existed between the agencies. Probably the one aspect of the reforms that was the least successfully implemented was that of congressional reform in terms of the structure of our oversight committees. But I think Director Clapper has done a remarkable job in a position which has a lot of responsibilities without necessarily a lot of authorities to go with it. And when I think of the DNI, I often think of a lot of big city mayors, and I know the cities differ around the country, but many of the city's mayors have a lot of responsibility and very little authority to actually make it happen. And it really depends on the power of the personality of the occupant to be effective, and I think Director Clapper has been very effective in harmonizing the strategies of the intelligence agencies, in developing common technology platforms, and I think has added tremendous value to the position and to the IC as a whole. I do think, as the chairman was saying, that we need to delve into DIA and its relationship to the commands. We did discover a problem at CENTCOM where their intelligence was overly optimistic in terms of the capabilities of the Iraqi special forces and minimizing the capabilities of the ISIL. And I think there were some reasons for that that were not reasons owing to political forces, but nonetheless some problems within the generation of intelligence at CENTCOM. So I do think that has caused us to want to examine more in depth the relationship between DIA and the intelligence coming out of the commands to make sure that our warfighters are getting the best possible intel. But I think the chairman is right. I wouldn't want to see a collapse of the DIA and CIA. I think they do properly have separate missions. If anything, I would like to see the CIA be able to spend more of its time focused on its core mission of intelligence collection and less involved in other areas that may detract from that core mission.
When I was a child, I worked for the Senate Foreign Relations Committee. And I can remember, I had to say it, during the atmospheric test ban, gives away how old I am. We had a joint hearing, Foreign Relations and Armed Services. It sounds like, you mentioned Chairman Thornberry, has your committee and the Armed Services Committee gotten together on this? Have you contemplated a joint hearing? Is there some way?
Well, one of the things that we did when Adam and I came into these roles is that we, for the first time, read in with ex officio members, both the chairman and the ranking member of the Armed Services Committee. So they're essentially non-voting members of the committee, but they receive all the same briefs that we do. We did the same thing with the Defense Appropriations chairman and ranking member. And for the most part, that solved a lot of the challenges and that we've dealt with in the past. Not all of them, and there remain some, but I think the system's working much better than before. And I think that gets to Adam's point about that Congress needs to make some adjustments. And we tried. It's not perfect, but it's getting better.
Because that's one of the questions that's come up from the audience, which is the whole oversight structure of the community at large. I mean, you've got judiciary, Homeland Security. My memory is you've got representatives on your committee.
From each
just
committee.
Just for that committee, that reason.
That's right, that's right. I think if we were going to, there's, just like I said, there's talking about the whole DNI, DOD, and all of that structure, and that major changes need to be made. The same holds true for Congress. But changes are so difficult there because of the institutions and the committees and the time. But I think there is a major disconnect between authorizing committees and appropriating committees. And that really needs to be changed, but it's so hard to change. I think it's ripening in terms of a time for it to be changed. And you're starting to see that just it's becoming harder and harder to get appropriations bills done. The authorizing bills are difficult. I think members are very frustrated. You know, if you serve on, you know, the agricultural committee, a lot of times you can't get anything done at USDA unless you work with the appropriations committee. And so that becomes difficult because you might have just a few people that sit on the agriculture appropriations committee versus a whole host of folks who spend a lot more time on the agricultural issues. That's just one example. But I think it holds true across the entire government. So it's not just related to the Intelligence Committee. I think it's every branch of government. I think it's very easy for the executive branch to hide from Congress as long as Congress is divided. And if you look at, point out a memo that was circulated within the Department of Defense, it was basically a political memo put out by senior leadership there on how to divide and conquer Congress. I mean, it's very, very troubling that something like that would be circulated within DOD, but my guess is that that's happening across all branches of government.
You know, I would just add, I think the innovation that we've made of having the chair and ranking of the HASC as well as the HACD sit by designation on Intel has been very beneficial. The only improvement I would love to see on that is reciprocity. Not that the chairman and I have so much time on our plate that this would be easy, but I think it would be valuable for us to have the similar opportunity to sit in on some of the HASC and HACD proceedings vis-a-vis the HASC, because there's still, I think, some opaqueness to the areas where your Title 10 and Title 50 operations are colliding with each other, where we have visibility into the one but poor visibility into the other on the Intel Committee. And similarly, although I think we've done a much better job coordinating the appropriations and authorization process, nonetheless, we do find ourselves surprised by some of the appropriation bills. And it may be advantageous for us to be able to sit in on some of the appropriations hearings to make sure that we have better coordination of appropriation authorization. So I would love to see us have the same reciprocal rights that we've granted to our colleagues in the other committees.
Just one more on that area. If you have a continuing resolution, which is now being discussed, what's the, I know the impact on defense, what's the impact on intelligence?
Well, for the most part, we've been, the intelligence community at this point, I think the Congress has been very supportive. I mean, there's been, we've been able to meet most of our objectives, and there hasn't been any cuts that have been too damaging. I think the bigger challenge is the budgeting and the programming and the long-term ability of the IC and our military to properly plan. I think that's the big challenge, and I mean, and it gets back to what we were talking about earlier, which is not having the Congress passing authorization bills on a whole host of areas. And I'll just, one pops to mind that I think is that makes things much more difficult for our military and intelligence services, and that is State Department. The State Department really needs to be, if I had to pick one agency that needs to be reformed, I mentioned DOD already, but I think the State Department might be even above that. And they're desperately in need of reform. And all of those, it's critical our intelligence community and our military rely on a properly functioning State Department. And I can tell you that one of the challenges that we have, both Adam and I, we try to get out to the field as much as possible, and we try to encourage our members to get out to the field as much as possible. And we've tried to divide the globe so that we're getting members and staff to cover the globe, so we have pretty good perspective on what's going on out there. And I can tell you the one thing that concerns me continually is the focus on generalizations at the State Department, where we're sending Americans in maybe for a two-year tour. And we're teaching them a language, they go somewhere for 2 years. Well, the reality of that is they're on the ground for maybe over a year. And I think it's a waste of taxpayer money. I don't think it's possible unless you're one of the few people that have really good linguistic capabilities. You're not really gonna learn the language, you're not gonna learn dialects, not gonna learn the culture. And I think we really gotta look at people that work for the State Department should be deployed for 4 to 6 years. Possibly, 2 years with a renewal, 2 years with a renewal based on performance. But that would be one change that I think is desperately needed, because we're spending too much time training people in languages and moving them around, and we don't develop, we do a good job at developing generalists, but we don't end up with any specialists.
I would certainly agree that if we're forced to rely on a CR, it's far from ideal in terms of the long-term planning of the intelligence agencies, and really makes them confront the same challenges as with the Defense Department. That they have to kind of take from Peter to pay Paul, merely do some short-term fixes, but really don't know whether they can sustain long-term efforts. So far less than ideal. I think on the intel side of things, we've been among the most functional in terms of being able to allow the IC to plan, but nonetheless, these CRs really hurt. And the only thing else I would say in that regard, and one of the reasons I think that the IC has had some more stability than perhaps some of our other agencies, is the chairman and I have worked very well together. It's a great working relationship. The Intel Committee is, I think, probably the least partisan on the Hill. I think that's a function of the subject matter. I think it's also a function of how we conduct the committee, how our predecessors conducted the committee, and I think in no small part because the committee meets in closed session. There's no grandstanding in a closed session because there's no one to grandstand to. So we get right to business, and probably some of the best debates we've had in the Intel Committee on issues we can't talk about here have cut across all different lines in the committee. You don't see Democrats lining up on one side and Republicans on the other. You see members of both parties really trying to grapple with what's the best approach, what's the right answer, just as you would want it to be. And that's not an argument for non-transparency, but I do think it's a function of a number of factors, and we're very fortunate that the partisan differences on Intel are really few and far between.
Let me go back to cyber, and I think one of the issues that you mentioned not being able to talk about. How do you declare war in the cyber realm? I mean, you have allegations about the Russians, allegations about the Chinese. I can ask you, what are we doing about it? And you can't say. But it's brought up all the time. How do you talk to the American public about how you're dealing, or how's the administration going to do it?
Well, I'd say the first goal is to do no harm in any policy decisions that we make. So there's a lot of discussion, a lot of money being thrown at cyber. But I always start with a couple assumptions. One is that anything you put on email is likely being intercepted if somebody's targeting you, and it doesn't have to be a nation state. Number two, if you're on a cell phone and somebody's targeting you, likely they're listening. And I think everyone, especially people who work in government, should operate under those assumptions. So, you know, in terms of cyber war, where does war begin and end? I don't know. I mean, that's probably both a legal and a philosophical question. One of the challenges that we're dealing with is you know, NSA has a lot of the sophisticated tools that we need, and they have the professionals in terms of that have the qualifications in math and science. And some of the best people, smartest people that we have in this country are at NSA. So the challenge always is well, do you create a cyber, you know, with cybercom, do you split those apart? And you know, we're grappling with that now. And I just don't know. The concern that I have is I don't want to create another bureaucracy without a mission, because it's cool for everybody to be in cyber. It's kind of the cool thing to be involved in, but the reality is that the technology is moving faster than the government and the bureaucracies of government can move.
Walter, I would say that in terms of how we respond to cyber attacks and what constitutes a cyber war, every situation is going to be different because the nature of the cyber tools are so diverse. The fact that we are attacked in a cyber way doesn't mean that the response is going to be a cyber attack by us on our adversaries. In the case of the hacks of DNC and DCCC, for example, I've been urging that the administration make public attribution of the responsible party. I think there's plenty of simply publicly available evidence that Russia is behind these hacks. And I think that the American people ought to know if a foreign government is trying to interfere somehow in their political process. So I think in some cases it will begin with naming and shaming the responsible parties. Depending on the nature of the cyber attack, that may deter some. It won't deter all. In the case of a hack that is for foreign intelligence gathering purposes, we're not going to enter into an agreement with some other power where they're going to agree not to hack us for intelligence gathering. If they think it's in their national security interest to do so, they're going to hack in. But hacking in is one thing. Dumping information, interfering in a political process is something quite different. Hacking in to do damage, as North Korea did, is something yet again different. And I think we need to look at each of these circumstances and figure out what's the right remedy. In the case of Chinese hacking, where the purpose is, for example, to gain trade secrets, intellectual property, there you can try to establish, as the president has, rules of the road. There you may want to take action of indicting responsible parties, of upping the ante. In the North Korean case, we don't, I think, want to get in a cyber tit for tat with a country that has very little to lose, that is North Korea, where their infrastructure is so poor. where they could do great damage to our own infrastructure. But it may mean that we respond to a cyber attack by the North Koreans by doing something they vehemently dislike, which is a propaganda effort in North Korea through loudspeakers, through leaflets, through other means to inform the North Korean people of what a terrible regime they live under. That would get the North Koreans' attention, and I would want the North Koreans to know that their cyber attacks on American companies don't go with impunity, that they're going to invite a response that they're not going to like. That, I think, would be a better deterrent than hacking into North Korean systems and inviting them to counter-hack into American systems. And so with the Russians, I think you begin by naming and shaming them. I think you also consider whether you, if they escalate, whether you sanction them, either using more broad economic sanctions or using something like the Magnitsky Law to sanction individual parties that are responsible. But I think the failure to act, the failure to establish any deterrent, failure to even name the responsible party, particularly in the case of Russia, only invites further exploitation, further attack, and the further effort to disrupt our elections. So I do think a response is warranted.
Let me go broader, another question from the audience. About the question is, do you feel that looking out into, as you, Congressman Schiff said, getting the CIA to focus more on gathering intelligence, what's your view on how we look out on the future, sort of anticipating? The questioner here says ISIS, Arab Spring, Crimea.
Well,
how do you see the record, and how do you see the future coming?
Well, that's always the challenge, right? So it's the old, I think Director Clapper says, that there's only policy success and intelligence failures. I'll go back to what I said earlier. I think there's got to be improvements, first and foremost, in the State Department. There's some fundamental problems there that I'm not actually going to blame on any administration. I just think there just needs to be some long-term changes, probably changes that were made decades ago that need to be looked at and changed. And Congress has got to play a role in that, and so do we, and even on the Intelligence Committee. And so that would be kind of our first line of defense, is improvement there. Then obviously that helps, that helps us improve across the other IC components that we have, with DOD and CIA. But I think for those that are wishing that we can predict these things in the future, I just don't know how likely that is. I think the best thing we can do is not have politicized intelligence. Adam mentioned CENTCOM. I think there's still some concerns with DOD specifically about the timeliness of information that they provide information to Congress, whether that be intelligence products, missions that may have occurred. Adam mentioned the Title 10 and Title 50. We've made a lot of progress on that front. We really have, but it's not nearly where it needs to be yet. It is easy for an administration or a branch of the military or intelligence agency to hide in the cracks of Title 10 and Title 50. And so that's some of the challenges that Adam and I have, I believe, made improvements upon, but we're not there yet.
Walter, I think with the agency, there are a couple issues. One that I mentioned, how much are they focused on their core mission of intelligence collection, and how much are they doing other things? And then, within the core mission of intelligence collection, are we focusing so much on the near-term threats, the proximate threats like ISIS, that we are neglecting the longer-term challenges of Russia, China, and elsewhere? There's no way to draw a fine or bright line here, and I think Director Brennan has done an excellent job. The challenge, I think with the IC, very much like the Defense Department, is that it's a big ship that takes a long time to turn. And so if you decide, as we have, that Russia is an increasing priority in terms of our necessity of gaining insight on what they're doing, what their motivations are, you can't train Russia people overnight, both linguistically and in all the other ways that you need to train up your workforce. So that takes time, and I think those changes are in progress. But one of the things on the committee that we really try to keep an eye on is, are we so focused on the imminent threat of terror that we are neglecting the longer-term challenges facing the country? And we want to make sure that the IC is doing that balance correctly and that they get input from the policymakers. But I imagine that's going to be a continual struggle. Certainly if, you know, when there's an attack, then it may cause you to wonder, are we spending too much time on long-term threats and not enough on the near-term? So, you know, as Chairman Nunes was saying, the director's quite right when he says there are only two things in the intel world, and that is policy successes and intel failures. We're awfully demanding of our IC. We know they don't have clairvoyance or a crystal ball, but we are doing the best we can to make sure that each are focused on their core mission and that they're allocating their resources in a way to cover both the near and the far-term threats.
Another question that's come up from the floor, which is personnel. I think the intel community has done well recruiting. The question is, how do you compete for technologically savvy people in an era when there's so much money floating around in the commercial side? Is there going to be special pay for special people? How do you deal with training people and keeping them?
I would say just quickly, and Adam can chime in on this too, but the biggest challenge we face are with the math and science experts, programmers. I think that is our, and engineers, that is our, that's our major challenge. I think for the most part, if you look at the professionals that are out there within DOD and the other national intelligence programs, we have a lot of really good people. They're really smart, really capable. It's, you know, we can be, of course, it's our job to provide oversight, so you have to be critical to some degree, but as government agencies go, the IC is quite nimble compared to other government agencies, and the high competence level of the people that work within the IC is smartest and brightest and most committed Americans that do very difficult work in very difficult places. And that's why it's our job to try to facilitate. I'll bring up, for the third time now, this issue with the State Department, right? So that's one of our challenges, is that, we want to make life better for our people that serve overseas. Well, one of the ways you do that is by not having their lives disrupted all the time. And so, because you want to make it as comfortable as possible and get the most bang for the buck in terms of what the taxpayer is spending. So some changes can be made, I think, on that front, but I the concern that I have would be on our technical experts as it relates to computer science, engineering, math, that sort of thing.
Walter, it's a great question because we continue to be able to attract some of the very best and brightest. And when you consider the competition, it's really quite extraordinary that we can continue to do that. When I think about young people who are graduating from some of the top universities with advanced degrees in math and science and the STEM fields, and they have the choice of going to the Silicon Valley and working in an environment where they can go to work in shorts. There's a sushi bar on the first floor and a coffee station every 100 yards and beanbag chairs, and it looks like you never left the university.
It looks like the Intelligence Committee.
I wish the Intelligence Committee looked like that. You know, what makes a young person decide to go to NSA and earn a lot less and work in a facility that looks nothing like Apple, Google, Facebook, you name it? You have to, I think, try to understand, you know, what is the motivation for someone today, particularly post-Snowden, to go to work at NSA, to go to work at CIA and the other agencies, NGA and all the others. You know, really, it really takes someone with a very special motivation, someone who is, I think, attuned to a lot of the national security threats and dangers facing the country, and that is committed to working on that problem set and understands they'll be given, you know, relative to their years, a great responsibility in attacking those problems. And thank goodness that we continue to attract those people. But I think it's an ongoing, persistent challenge, because as the wages go up in the Silicon Valley and they're frozen in government service, it gets tougher and tougher. And it's also one of the reasons why we have to continue to develop these innovative partnerships with the private sector. And we have some great partnerships in the Silicon Valley. It's also why we need to try to reduce the decibel level in the occasional fights and disagreements between the IC and the Silicon Valley, because we need a strong collaborative relationship. And Devin and I spend a lot of our time going to Silicon Valley, meeting with Silicon Valley leaders that come to Washington to make sure that we have open lines of communication, that we understand and recognize the value they're adding. We want those companies to thrive. We need them to thrive, both economically and as a national security matter. It's greatly beneficial that they are doing so well and that they are the platforms of choice around the world. But, you know, I think what we have to continue to try to achieve is a great recruitment program for our agencies to attract a new workforce, as we have a lot of people aging out and retiring from our IC. And at the same time, really cultivating these relationships with the private sector so that we have a good collaboration, and we can still derive the benefit for those brilliant people who go to work out in my home state rather than come to work in the IC.
Let me get into a slightly different thing that tracks with defense. The questions of satellites, drones in the intelligence area. Do you get into this issue of launching satellites? I mean, NRO, NGA, etc. And also the whole question of the appeal of drones and gathering that kind of information. Have we caught up? This is another part of my past. There was a time when satellites first started picking things up that material was gathered, but there was so much of it you couldn't see it. And that's been a problem with the growth of drones. How are we working that one out?
Well, I make, first off, I mean, clearly we are one of the biggest cost drivers is launch. Everybody's familiar with the SpaceX and the OLA argument. From my perspective, we need competition. We need to drive down costs. At the same time, we have to have reliability. So we grapple, I think, with those questions, launch questions, quite regularly. When you look at, I'll just briefly say in terms of ISR, I think, Adam, I don't know if you get this overseas, but it seems like everywhere I go, every country wants ISR. And I'm not quite sure why sometimes, because I think that it's probably over. I think the reliance on this as a tool is probably, I think, overstated. You know, in the long run, I just don't think that. I think drones are very important, going to be critical, but it still takes human intelligence, and I think in this digital age, it's going to take more human intelligence, not less. So drones are not the answer to all our world's problems, nor our satellites, but critical.
Before I became ranking on the full committee, I was ranking on the technical and tactical subcommittee, which oversees the aerial platforms. and our overhead architecture. And it is, I think, one of the most challenging of all of the intel assignments, and probably among the least discussed publicly, because, you know, the human intelligence and other aspects of the IC have so much more captured the American imagination. But our overhead assets are obviously phenomenally important, and a lot of the people in this room are intimately familiar with them. They're also enormously costly, and I think the two areas where there is the greatest risk of a massive investment that goes unrealized is in the area of overhead architecture and in the area of cyber. Those are, I think, among the most important oversight responsibilities for our committee, because we invest massive amounts of money, and if you make that investment imprudently, you launch something that is of limited utilization or in fact doesn't work, or you employ a cyber system or defense that doesn't work and you've invested billions. And so this is an area that is keenly deserving of the most vigorous scrutiny, which we try to give it, and is of enormous consequence. Chairman is absolutely right. You can't over-rely on the intelligence you get from overhead systems, and it's no substitute for having good human intelligence. But the two working together, the two tipping and cueing each other, can be phenomenally important and have been to our counterterrorism effort, our non-proliferation effort. So these are enormously important systems and investments, and we are continually trying to find new models of delivery to bring the cost of these systems down. We're looking always for new and game-changing technologies that can really leap forward beyond what our adversaries are doing, because they're also very aggressive in this area. And it's a phenomenal challenge, but one which I think is where probably have the closest working relationship between the public and private sectors.
Well, I want to thank you both. We're right at 9:15, and that's time to quit. So thank you both
for
coming.
Thank you all.
Thank you.